I'm gonna do a quick teardown on this little infrared thermometer temperature sensor thing, non-contact temperature sensor. It's just a cheap one from Princess Auto, but I've been carrying it around in my toolbox for a while, as you may be able to tell from the schmudginess and stuff. But at some point, the trigger switch has been damaged here, and it kind of doesn't really work. So hopefully I can figure out, maybe it's just a mechanical problem inside I can work around. Otherwise, it's a one-way teardown. I've never been inside one of these things, so I'm kind of curious to see what's going on. This one's got a little laser that shoots out there just for targeting, and then there's a lens. I don't know if you can see it. And then there's a lens deep down in there, which actually does the measuring somehow. Looks like it's got a little Fresnel lens in there, or Fresnel, depending on how you pronounce that, to focus it. That's kind of interesting. And we'll get in here in a second and see if we can figure out what's going on. So on the side here, well, the other side's got the typical warnings. This side gives you some information about how big a spot you can measure. So basically, it's a 12 to 1 ratio. So 2 feet out, you can measure 2 inches. 3 feet out, you can measure 3-inch circle. So it gets a little bit less precise. It takes a bit more of an average. Or that 12 to 1 still goes in meters, but it's a little bit harder to math out in your head, so we shan't worry about that. I'm not going to go too deep. This isn't a science video. This is just me being curious more than anything. So this here is our subject today. Just a generic infrared thermometer from Princess Auto. Power Fist brand, which means it's the cheapest China export one that they could find and slap their branding on. They're selling it for $70. It's clearly not a cheap technology if this cheap ass one is $70. What do we know about it? It can measure -50 to +460. So, okay, you can use it for checking your barbecue's temperature, I guess, for cooking. That's kind of handy. Not quite smelting temperature, though. Accuracy +/-1.5 Celsius. 0.2 resolution, response time, 1,000 milliseconds, so a second. Emissivity, I'm not quite sure what that means. I think that's got to do with how well the target gives off heat, but I'm not sure. And like I said, this isn't going to be a science video. And there's that 12 to 1 ratio again. Uses 2 AAA batteries, and that's about it. Anyway, here's the manual for it, and it's not much. It's just got the specs again, and safety. Warning, do not stare into the laser. Duh. It's a little bit sensitive to high EMF, so arc welders and induction heaters. I suppose transmitters as well, maybe. I don't know. If you want to go deep on these things, there is a bit of an article over at Wikipedia, because there's an article on everything at Wikipedia. What this guy's using it for is kind of what I use it for most of the time, just checking to make sure the air conditioning is working reasonably well. And make sure there's no hot spots on the equipment, but mostly for that. I'm not going to go through all of this. Typical accuracy, +/-2 Celsius, 4 Fahrenheit. This thing claims to be a little bit more accurate than that. It talks about that distance to spot ratio again. Yeah, but that's not why we're here. So here it is in all its glory. The only thing that works is the Celsius Fahrenheit button. You can kind of see that there. The backlight's kind of ginched up a little bit, but it's not really showing me anything else. The hold light is on, the battery indicator, but it's showing max, but the actual temperature isn't displaying. And of course that trigger's buggered up some. Okay. I just reefed on it enough and I've got the trigger. Although the laser dot, the targeting dot, is supposed to only be on when the trigger's pulled, so now the trigger's kind of jammed the other way. But it's showing that my workbench is 19 degrees and that my coffee is about 35. Okay. So that was easier than I thought, and it's showing right now that the maximum temperature that it's measured. Oh, okay. So it kind of holds the maximum, which is my coffee, until I pull the trigger and find something else, I guess. 67, yeah. Or until I shut off the trigger. Okay. Anyway, so it is kind of working. The trigger needs some effort, though. And the backlight's not nearly as lit as it should be, but whatever. Still, I was always planning on taking this apart and not concerning myself too much if it went back together, because it's not a very high quality one, and I do have a better one at work. So let's whip these screws out. There's a couple of screws under the battery compartment here. One there and one cleverly hidden under the serial number tag. I wonder if that serial number is legit or if it's just a random number that they throw on to make it look like it's serialized and worthy. Get out. Come on there. Okay. Spudger. Get in here. Looks like it's still clipped up at the top or something. Is that? Huh. Oh, there we go. So, and here we have, oh, that's cheesy. The trigger's just got bent springs, so it's just kind of been jammed. Okay. Play with that later. Anyway, so what do we have in here? Starting down at the bottom, we have batteries. We have, oh, so some test points or something, and another set up there. A, G, ground probably, C, clock data voltage. Don't know what A would be. And up here we got ground, DI, DIO, DCL, CD3, and V. Possibly programming headers or data headers for maybe that guy and maybe this blob-o-matic up here. Does that serial number match this one? No, it doesn't. So maybe they are random numbers. I'm actually surprised to see a serial number in there. Anyway, what do we got going on here? Got the laser diode for targeting. Let's zoom out a bit. That laser, where's one of those ones that I got in the mailbag a little while ago? Yeah, there it is. Not that much different. This one is just, that feels kind of hot glue-ish, sticking it in there. I guess just to aim it so that it's aimed more or less at the center of this guy. What else is there to see on this side of the board? Well, let's see what that little 8-pin chip is. It is CSI 93C66V1. All right, I couldn't find the exact part number, but 93C66 always seems to turn up a little EEPROM of various different sizes. This isn't the exact one, of course. I couldn't find the V1 version, but this is, I think, close enough for what we're doing here. So yeah, it's basically just a little EEPROM chip select. Serial clock, data in, data out. So it's probably, oh, there we go, V. Temperature range is V. So it's good for wide range of temperatures. Okay, that's all that part means. So yeah, presumably that is being used to hold calibration data or something. Remember that the some of the pins appear to be broken out to a test header on it, so that would make a certain amount of sense for holding calibration data, I suppose. Do we go deeper? Sure, we're in this far. One thing I like about this screwdriver, whoop, and get in past stuff. Okay, zoom out a little bit so you can see this whole thing. What happens here? Oh, so there is, there's the screen. And it looks like, yeah, those are those fancy magical little zebra stripes. And that's where they talk down onto the board. And backlit LED, anode and cathode. That would be the backlight. It probably should be attached to that, not just falling off. And there is the LCD screen with its, can we see any of the graphics on it by shining lights on it? No, just fingerprints. Well, if I put that back in, which way should it go in to go? I don't know, does it go that way? Oh, no, there's a little nubbin here and it collides with that. So this probably goes that way up. Looks like the case is holding it fairly solidly in alignment. And there's an alignment pin there that aligns with the board, so. Okay. How was this? I think that was that way in there. So here's our pushy button for mode, just Celsius Fahrenheit on there, which makes contact with, we have three switches, potential switches here, but there's only one conductive pad there. So mode is the middle one. That one is SW down. That one is SW up. Wonder what they would do. Down and up. Can I get voltage onto there to try it? No, I can't. No, I can't try those without the LCD. Leave that out and just poke a poke. Yeah. I'm curious, but I don't know. Any guesses? Has anybody seen a little bit higher end model of this one that has the three buttons? Anyway, we have two more screws, which will take this assembly out. Maybe we can see what the sensor looks like. That could be exciting. So there is what the sensor looks like. A little four-pin device in a can. Do we have any markings on it at all? Nothing. He's anonymous. Unless there's something on the bottom side, but no, I don't see anything down there. Well, that's a little disappointing. Would have been nice to know who that guy is. Doing a bit of googling around for infrared temperature sensor, I found some things that look like the right thing anyway. It probably isn't exactly the right one, but it does have the right form factor, and the description seems to be reasonable. Contactless temperature measurement used in various applications, right? The different types that they sell can either talk SPI or I2C or RS-232. So that's interesting. There's four pins on it. Power and ground and, I don't know, SCL and SDA or MESO-MOSI or TX-RX. Something like that. Sure. Also, while we're zoomed way in here, it looks like there should be there could also be a buzzer there for reasons. Go with me on this little tangent. If there was a buzzer there, perhaps these up and downs, you could set a threshold and have it buzz when it exceeds the threshold. Possibly, maybe. I will spare you the pain of watching me put it back together, though. So that's all mostly back together. I'm just gonna grab this trigger out of here and see if I can either straighten out or completely break the plastic spring on it. So you can see that it's kind of warped there. It should be kind of like that. So if I put some pressure, maybe if I bend it back and just throw a little bit of warmth at it, just to soften the plastic and get it to set in the opposite direction of the bend that it's gotten itself into.
A little later.
That seems to be back where it's supposed to be. Okay. So let's toss her back together and see if it works. Let's see, now there's a clip up at the top there, and put these two screws back in here. Oh, just noticed, remember those test pads on the board? There they are, available there with V on that side and the rest of them there in the order that the manufacturer would know of. So it looks like you can, maybe it's a calibration or something, I don't know. It's on. The laser comes on when I squeeze the trigger. And it shows a temperature. 33 degrees there, 25 over there, 24 over there. Back wall, 21 on the back wall. I'll buy that. I've had the heat gun going down here, so that's why that's warmer than it was before. So I think I can call that a win-ish. I have no illusions that this thing isn't going to get bent again. It's kind of jangly already, but I don't know, maybe I can find some kind of a case to put it in my toolbox so that it doesn't get completely jammed again. And the fact that I'm hoping that I didn't break that taking it apart, the connection to the backlight, I'm going to think that it's from living a rough life. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you found that slightly informative. I was interested to see what was going on inside there. Never had one of these apart before. Thanks again. Talk to you later.